my door. I am so excited to be able to make it here to Wagner's. I can't wait to tell you what we got going on for this week. See you later.
Oh, man, I love coming to Wagner's. They always have the best produce and yummy goodness. As you're looking at fruit, oh, I tell you, some raspberries. Oh, here's a fruit cup. This one's delicious. I'll take some of that. Oh, yes. Who could beat a Honeycrisp? Oh, here's one. This is. This one looks delicious. But you know what? There's no better fruit than the fruit of the spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Mmm. That hits the spot.
Special and cool time where you might hear some people talking about making new goals. And they might say things like,
I'm gonna read more.
I'm going to eat healthier.
I'm gonna get more sleep.
So whether you're someone who decides to make goals for the new year or someone who doesn't, one thing that we can all agree on is that we all need to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus because his ways are the best ways. In fact, God's word says that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And we learn what real love is when we keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. So happy New Year, everyone. And let's love Jesus and love others.
Happy New Year!
Thank you. chapter 5, verses 1 through 7. I would sing a song for the Lord. He is the one I love. It's a song about his vineyard, Israel. The one I love had a vineyard. It was on a hillside that had rich soil. He dug up the soil and removed its stones. He planted the very best vines in it. He built a lookout tower there. He also cut out a wine press for it. Then he kept looking for a crop of good grapes. But the vineyard produced only bad fruit. So the Lord said, "People of Jerusalem and Judah, you be the judge between me and my vineyard. What more could I have done for my vineyard? I did everything I could. I kept looking for a crop of good grapes, so why did it only produce bad ones? Now I will tell you what I am going to do to my vineyard. I will take away its fence, and the vineyard will be destroyed. I will break down its wall, and people will walk all over my vineyard. I will turn my vineyard into a dry and empty desert. It will not be pruned or taken care of. Thorns and bushes will grow there. I will command the clouds not to rain on it. The vineyard of the Lord who rules over all is the nation of Israel. The people of Judah are the vines he took delight in. He kept looking for them to do what is fair, but all he saw was blood being spilled. He kept looking for them to do what is right, but all he heard were cries of suffering."
First Noel, the angel did say, was too certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they lay keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night that was so deep.
Oh, 5, verses 22 and 23. But the fruit the Holy Spirit produces is love, joy, and peace. It is being patient, kind, and good. It is being faithful and gentle, and having control of oneself. There is no law against things of that kind.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to join me in prayer. Oh, Lord God Almighty, we do thank you for this time. Albeit we wished we could be together in corporate worship, recognizing, yes, we long to be in your presence. Yet the convenience that technology brings us to still gather, to encounter your truth, to be able to engage in this, your holy word, we pray that you would be working mightily with us even today. That as we, as individuals, family, close friends, look at this text of Isaiah 5 and Galatians 5, that you would speak to us, Lord, words of wisdom, and that you, O Lord, would instruct us so that even now the words of my mouth and the meditations upon our hearts would be made acceptable in your sight. For you alone are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Wow, you read this passage from Isaiah, and first thing that comes to mind for me is the essence of heartbreak. I mean, absolute deep heartbreak. I don't know about you, but maybe you've had an experience, and quite possibly even over this Christmas holiday, where a family member has come home, or an individual that you really have a deep affection for, or a concern or love for, and they have gone astray, or maybe been lured into another place, or engaged in activity that you know is destructive, and your heart aches because you know how much energy you've poured into that person. And now you see wild grapes and you wonder, what has happened here? Why is this happening? And that essence of just disappointment, right? That heartbreak. This is what the Lord is communicating as he writes this song to his beloved and says, what more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I look for it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? Right now, I'd like you to take a few moments. Just pause the tape. Well, welcome back, friends. I hope you had a good discussion. I'm certain it may have stirred up some waters for you, and I hope that it's ultimately been a very fruitful discussion along that idea of the heartbreak of what happens when we see someone that's being lured away into a place that you know is not good. Well, here we come to Galatians, and what we see is Paul writing to a church that he sees is being lured away into a place that's not good. That's kind of funny because so many of us know our New Testament lesson inside out and backwards from Galatians 5, 22 and 23. Matter of fact, we have this proclivity of compartmentalizing those 9 different aspects of the fruit of the Spirit. So much so that we even add an S to that, fruits of the Spirit, implying that Now, these are separate fruits like grapes, bananas, oranges, you know, pineapple. And you have all these different fruits that, well, you can pick and choose, right? Or maybe we look at it and say, well, this is kind of in accordance to my spiritual gifting. I'm more gentle than I am self-controlled. Or I have way more peace in my life than I have goodness. I don't know how people like to play the game, but the reality is, as Paul is writing to the church of Galatia, he is giving them a real recipe of how it is that the Spirit of God should be at work in our lives. And we're going to examine that, because what we see is a real love letter that Paul is writing to the church of Galatia, and it's coming off as, you know, almost as a guardian or a teacher, right? We're going to come to that word. Looking at a student that they highly value and recognizing, oh, my friend, what are you doing? Why are you going this direction? You know better. So this is what Paul's doing. It's kind of a heartbreak for him to see what has happened to the church of Galatia. He's disappointed. And so he's not going to totally tear down the walls and the hedgerow that's built around it and rip up the wine press. No, he's not going to do that. But he is going to bring them into a gentle correction of their behavior, because they've been lured away into a place that is not healthy. And we see it right at the very beginning of the letter that he writes to the Galatian church. And I think I'm going to take you on a quick journey through a portion of Paul's letter to Galatia so that we have a better sense of what's going on at Galatians 5, and to be able to see the fruit of the Spirit as Paul intends us to understand it, or at least in my research, as I discern that Paul is kind of driving us toward. So first, you got to look at chapter 1, and here it is. He gives his typical entry, and you know, oh, hey, great to meet you, see you guys, and grace and peace from God our Father, our Lord Jesus Christ. That whole normal Paul kind of greeting. But then he comes right into it. Sometimes he says, I thank my God for every time I remember you, or all these different ways. With the Galatian church, no, he comes right out and he says to them, I am astonished, right? I'm bamboozled. I find myself without words as to why, right? Isn't that sometimes it happens? When you spend time with somebody and you see them go in a place, you're like, I have a hard time comprehending this. So this is what Paul is saying. And he says, I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel. Not that there is another one, but there are some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. You see, Paul is investing into these churches, and specifically this one in Galatia and all of Asia Minor. And here, he's addressing a very, very serious problem. Matter of fact, we read about it in Acts at the Jerusalem Council, where Paul goes toe-to-toe with Peter. Because Peter was one who is being lured into an understanding that, ooh, you know what? Some of the old Jewish law needs to still be enacted here, like circumcision and dietary laws, these kinds of things, right? Oh, some of this Levitical stuff that was there that we read in the book of Leviticus. There is an expectation for these new converts, as they're coming in, that you need to become more Jewish in your expression. And Paul was, you know, a Jew of the Jews, you know, Pharisee of Pharisees, he writes. And he goes toe-to-toe with Peter on this, because Paul is going out into the Gentile world and sharing the message of Jesus Christ, who redeems us, right, and fulfills the law. And so this is what Paul is really kind of what has happened to you? So we read later on, as we go on in chapter 3, he says this in verse 1. He says, oh, foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Right? Wow, what an image, right? It's coming right out. What has gotten into you? You see, because as we look in chapter 2, right, here at verse 16, is a critical point that we need to see. And I'll start with 15. He says, we ourselves are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners. And he's acknowledging something about himself. Paul, Peter, some of the others. Yeah, we're Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners. He's not being like obstinate or ignorant by saying that. He's acknowledging something here. And he says, yet, this is very important. He says, yeah, I'm a Jew. I know I'm a Jew. And I know you guys are Gentiles. He's saying that to him. He says, but I'm telling you something here. Now listen, this is important. He says, yet, we know that a person is not justified by works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. So we also have believed in Christ Jesus in order to be justified by faith in Christ and not by works of the law. Because by works of the law, no one will be justified. Paul's spelling that out absolutely clearly. And we keep going here. You know, just to kind of keep flying along here in chapter 3, verse 24. He says, so then, here's what he acknowledges. And he uses a really cool imagery here. And I'm going to paint this picture out a little bit for you because it's helpful for us. And then we're going to take a moment, right? And then we'll come back in again. But stick with me here for this in verse 24, right? He acknowledges that we're justified by faith, right, through Jesus Christ. But he's not going to totally throw the law out the window yet, right? He knows it's there. And he's going to give these people who have been impacted by folks who are known as Judaizers, right? These Judaizers who are saying, you must be this way in your expression of Christianity. You've got to live into these certain law practices. And Paul's like, ha ha, no. And we come to 24, and he says this. He says, so then, the law was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under the guardian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. I don't know about you, but I did watch Guardians of the Galaxy Christmas special. And that whole idea of guardians, right, goes one step further. You know, I know that when I was doing youth ministry, I would become ex parentis of the children that would go on these trips with me. Basically, a guardian. Likewise for you, I'm sure. You've had opportunities where you are a guardian. Well, the idea that Paul is using here was one that the Galatians were very familiar with because the Greeks and the Romans had this in place, these tutors, these schoolmasters, right? And the primary responsibility of these supervisors, of these tutors, of these guardians, right, was to help establish for them what is the way to live and how to establish proper morals. And believe it or not, those boys couldn't go anywhere without that tutor right there by their side. The law was that to kind of watch over you to make sure you didn't misstep or go the wrong direction, but kind of guide you along until, right, you get into the hands of your real master, right? In my case, as a youth director or any other trip leader that I would do, I'd take those children, guard them, make sure they're making wise decisions, making sure they're engaged with one another as a healthy community, bring them to their parents, right? Because those are the people that are ultimately responsible to raise that child. Not me, but I will certainly guard them while they're under my tutelage. Take a moment. Think about that. How is it that you have guarded an individual to make wise decisions, to be engaged in what they need to be able to do, to live into a life that is respectable and has a good, strong moral backbone? Take some time to think about that. Or think about this as well. How is it that you have been a guardian, have been under the tutelage of someone that's cared for you deeply? And what is it that you've gained from that experience? Talk about that for a moment. Think about it. We'll be back. Well, welcome back. I sure hope your discussion that took place just recently regarding those who have taken you under their wing and cared for you stirred up some lively conversation and a bit of encouragement at the same time. It is exciting to be in conversation along those lines when you think about what it is that God's doing in our lives. Well, we come back to our text here and we see in chapter 5 a very important transition that begins to take place as we move from a spot where quite possibly we've gained a bit more empathy for where Paul stands in his, you know, disappointment with the people of Galatia being lured away into a place where they really shouldn't be, or maybe even more so we can catch a glimpse of how it is that God is just heartbroken, right? As we read in the Isaiah chapter 5 passage of, you know, his beloved not producing the good grapes that he intended, but had gone after in wild directions. And so here we come into this text, even as we talked about how the law becomes that guardian or that tutor or that schoolmaster that kind of guides us through to make wise decisions. And when given under that guardianship or, you know, that opportunity to be away, or ex parentis, so to speak. So we come to chapter 5, verse 13 to verse 15. And I want us to take a peek at what Paul's saying here, because this is leading us into verse 22 and 23 of chapter 5. Part that we're going to be building on for this whole next 9 weeks or so. It says, "For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh. But through love, serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word." And I do believe you folks know what that one word is. You remember, and Matthew captures this the most dynamically, what are known as the three catch questions, you know, where people came up to him, challenge him about certain things. And there's this Pharisee that came up to Jesus, recognizing, oh, okay, Jesus kind of got the Sadducees on their resurrection question. I'll ask him about the law, right? Okay, Jesus, what is the greatest commandment? Trying to look at this, you know, there's 612 of them, the law. Now, and of that, there's the Ten Commandments. And here this Pharisee is trying to pin Jesus to the wall. And Jesus kind of looks at this guy, and I'm sure he looked at him with compassion, but also that disappointment, because he is the people, right? That is the way to phrase that word. He is the people that Isaiah is writing about. They're losing it, right? They've gotten themselves caught up into something that they shouldn't be engaged in, that's taken their eye off the ball of what it is that God's calling us to do. And so Jesus looks at him and says, well, if you were to summarize the law and the prophets, you would know it goes like this. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and strength. And second, love your brother, love your neighbor as yourself. That sums up the law, my friend. The Pharisee walked away because he knew. And Jesus had summarized the law absolutely perfectly. This is what Paul does with the church of Galatia. He's taking that law, a phrase that all those Judaizers would have known, and he puts it out there for them, and he says, you know, here you are, folks. You've been born into freedom. Remember, you're not under the yoke of slavery anymore of the law. You're not under the guardianship. That's not your true parent. Your true parent is Jesus Christ. He's come and he's made you an heir. So you're no longer a slave to the law, but you're free. Don't allow that freedom, right, to lure you back into some other fleshly, desiry thing. But look at what it is, the one pure thing that you need to do. Don't let it be an opportunity for flesh, but through love, serve one another, for the whole law is fulfilled in one word. Love your neighbor as yourself. Because what was happening is the divisions that were going on within the church. Divisions amongst the brothers and sisters in Christ. Because people, quote unquote, weren't living into what were the expectations that were needed to be embraced according to the Judaizers. They're putting up all these false standards of what needs to be happening and how it could be. And what it needs to be. But all the while losing what it really means to be a person of faith. Living into one who's been transformed by the love of God, by the Spirit's work in a person's life. Love your neighbor. Right? But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. You got to love that phrase. Because that's what happens. We get into these dickering fights. We start putting all these ideologies out in front of the declaration that Jesus is Lord. And those become our master and our idols. Then we divide the church. If we say you have to be this way, or you must pursue this kind of mindset, or you've got to be into this kind of world, or you must be identified as this kind of church, or you've got to be this way, or how you've got to look in this part of the world, or whatever it is, anything that is placed above the declaration that Jesus is Lord, it becomes a division in the church. How are you to love your neighbor if you're too quick saying, well, you don't live into this, or you're not this, and you don't have a yard sign, and you don't do that? How is that showing any love? We're stepping into a new year, my friends. We can let that past fade into the past. And we can step into this future that recognizes that we need to love our neighbor, even as we love ourselves. Maybe that's a whole other sermon I need to be preaching. But now we turn to chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. And now we understand what the fruit of the Spirit begins to illustrate for us. Since we are born of spirit and not of flesh, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And then Paul writes this. Against such things, There is no law. I had a conversation with my younger brother who came in from Colorado just for the holidays. And we got to talking. And he said, you know, Ted, it's interesting. He said, if we as people could just come around these ideas that really are embodied in Jesus, and it's just refreshing to hear him say this, that are embodied in Jesus, to just love one another, to pursue those concepts. I said, yeah, the fruit of the Spirit. And I outlined them. And he went, yeah, those are the things. I said, absolutely. There is no law to these. You can't. Everybody espouses these ideals and knows that they're valuable. It's a new year, my friend. Today, the very first day of 2023. We have the opportunity to live into these 9 because they apply to all of us who claim to be followers of Jesus Christ, transformed by His Spirit, released from bondage, and recognizing the hope and joy of a life redeemed. Ah, friends, Happy New Year, and God bless you. Let's spend some time praying, my friends. Oh Lord God Almighty, we thank you so very much for this Christmastide, in which we had the opportunity to share in the joy of the celebration of you coming into this world and dispelling the darkness, creating a world in a way that we would know that your love is made manifest and ultimately through your Son. Lord, as we start to tuck away our Christmas decorations and box things up for the end of the year here and begin a new year, we pray that you would fill us with your Spirit, that you would equip us to be a people that can orchestrate and initiate the expression of love and joy, peace and kindness, goodness, all those aspects of the fruit of the Spirit, that we would be a church family that looks for opportunities to be engaged so that we could serve, as Paul writes to the church of Galatia. This is what we desire to do. We want to bear good fruit, Lord. We want to be that vineyard that is not overgrown with briars and has allowed itself to become a wild patch, but one that is fruitful, one that is productive in our life of faith. Oh, Lord God Almighty, we pray for our world around us that is mired in the darkness. They're lost and trying to find their way. And we thank you for individuals like Paul who stepped out into the Gentile world to bear witness to your good truth, spread beyond just the confines of the Jewish heritage and into a place that recognizes that this message is for all people. And even as he wrote to the Galatian church, they're no longer Jew or Greek, slave or free, male or female. We are all one in Christ. And so, Lord, help us to be that same, have that same adventuresome spirit, to speak to those who may not be across some political lines that have been drawn by borders, but maybe it's an ideological political line. Maybe it's a line that is across the street, or maybe it's a reality that there are people who just do not even understand that you've come into the world. And Christmas has become a commercialized event, an experience packed with tradition. Lord, help us to be that church that speaks your truth with vibrancy and compassion, that people would feel welcome here and that they would know that our lives are centered on your word. Lord, 2023 lays out before us with all the opportunities that every new year brings. Sure, we make our resolutions and we know that many of them break within 24 hours of them being made. But we do resolve this year to be faithful ambassadors for your kingdom's sake, bearing fruit that reflects our deep and abiding love in you. Lord, how good it is to be able to come before your throne and to know that you love us so deeply, that you desire for us to be in conversation with us. And because of that, you've given us words to speak when we find ourselves tongue-tied. So hear now, even this word, that you taught your disciples long ago and even us today, to pray when we find ourselves in need of not knowing what to say. So we join our voices saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, how good it is for us to be gathered here in this space. I look forward to us being able to gather face to face. Hear now these words of the benediction. Go out into the world, my friends. Be an agent for the sake of the gospel. Be one who recognizes with confidence the love that Christ has for you. Don't be afraid to speak that truth, because people long to hear it. And friend, I pray that the work that God has begun in you will come to full completion. For we know that is to be the truth that God has assured for us. Happy New Year, folks. Go out and bear witness to the good news of Jesus Christ, who's come into the world and loves us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, let the people of God say, Amen.
see.